There's a lot of voices in the world today, and as Christians, whether we're adults or children, we need to be sure we're listening to the right ones. In today's cultures, so many Christians are just soaking in a variety of voices through music, movies, TV, social media, news, and more. Not to mention the questionable things our kids are being taught through books and our educational system. It's vital that we and they know how to tune in the voice of God and tune out the lies of the enemy. But how can we know the difference? Now, if you enjoy teachings like this, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe to this channel because I try to upload a new video every week. Also, be sure to share it with your friends. But for now, let's get started.
But we have to understand that when we begin to hear God's voice and begin to speak out what we're hearing, if we don't have a foundation of the written word of God, we cannot trust what we're hearing. And that's why last night's sermon was so important about Baal worship, because when you begin to blur those lines, trust me, Christian kids everywhere I go around the world are hearing from both sides equally, and they don't know which side is telling the truth. One of the things we're going to learn tonight is that we all see through a glass darkly. We all have a piece of the puzzle. We're all hearing God's voice. We just don't know what it is we're hearing many times. And the reason that this fits in so well with what everything else we're doing, and I hate it that I'm covering up all my pretty, that's the monk in me, okay? I just like to not have any, this, you know, okay. Anyway, but you've seen the backdrop, but it is on purpose that we put the Garden of Eden here, because this is where God started talking to the ear gate and to the spirit of man before there was ever a written word. And it was the spoken word of God in the Garden of Eden that the devil began to attack. Eve and Adam were hearing from both sides of the spirit world. And they did not have a book to go back to determine which one is telling me the truth. That's why you need to know your Bible. And if you are not a teenager, a Christian by now, and are not getting in your Bible, and I'm going to say every day, but I don't mean by legalism. I mean if your heart hunger is not driving you to get into the Word of God as often as you can, there is something wrong with your relationship with God. There is something wrong because you cannot know God outside of this Word. You will never for sure No, if you can't sit in a movie theater and distinguish between Baal worship and the truth of God's word, you don't know your Bible well enough. Either that or you're just not paying attention. Thank you. I was wondering if someone's going to catch that. Give him a piece of candy. So what we're talking about today is very foundational. This is where it all began. It began with Adam, the first Adam. It's going to end with the second Adam. Somewhere in between here is where we are. And we got to learn how to distinguish the voices from the two worlds that are talking to us all the time. And one of the clues that I can give you is that God's voice is not always a voice. He speaks in many ways, and hopefully we're going to get to it. But this is important for us to understand that we must learn to distinguish the voices in the garden of our heart, because both voices are speaking to us all the time. And if we don't know what this says, you cannot distinguish the voices. You know why so many of our Christian kids can sit in theaters and be totally insensitive to the witchcraft and the type of stuff they're seeing is because they've never dug into the Old Testament and begun to read the scriptures on witchcraft and what an abomination it is to God to even slightly participate. It was an abhorrence to God. And if we don't understand that as Christians, this did not pass away when Jesus came. The Old Testament did not pass away. But there's not a lot. You know what we do find in here? We find Jesus casting the devils out of people right and left. Because Baal worship never went away in the New Testament either. the culture that Jesus lived in, the Roman culture that Jesus lived in, their what was Julius Caesar, their Caesar, their king, whatever, he was the god. I mean, that was later after Jesus. I'm mixing up history here, but you understand. The Herods and the Pharaohs and all those, they were the gods of the day. They were into the animal. It was all around Jesus. Jesus did not live in a pure society where the only evil guys were the scribes and the Pharisees. Jesus walked by Asherah idols. Jesus walked by. Paul walked into a town where they had a god that they didn't even have a name for. And he says, I'm going to tell you who the God is that you're looking for. Those things were all around them. There was Baal worship all around them all the time. They had to learn to distinguish. So what we're doing back right now is we are going into a very elementary understanding of the spoken word of God. And we can't even start with that subject without going into the Garden of Eden. Because this is where it began. Because you see, when Jesus made man, the fascinating thing about it was, and I think I mentioned this on the first day sometime, is that when he made the worlds, he spoke and the sun, moon, and stars was in space. He spoke and the earth was formed. He spoke and we had night and day. He spoke and there were animals and birds and fish, and he spoke and there was vegetation. And he did speak. He did say, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. But he did something to man he didn't do to anybody else or any other living thing. He literally picked up the clay out of the ground and began to mold it with his hands. He took the clay and then he did something very unusual. The Bible tells us that he bent to the ground and he breathed into Adam's nose, his nostril, the breath of life. And when he did, he put some of himself inside of Adam. And that's what caused Adam to become a living creature. A living soul. Creature not in a creature like a monster creature. A living being. Adam came to life when the life of God was breathed down on the inside of him. Now what's the significance of that? The Bible says that God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. It also says that the word breath that was used in that scripture, where God breathed into Adam the breath of life, the root Hebrew word of that word breath is spirit. So when God breathed into Adam the breath of life, he put some of himself inside of Adam. He put his own spirit inside of Adam, and Adam became a living soul. Now, cutting the story a bit short, do you remember what happened when God spoke to Adam and Eve and he says, don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because in the day you do, you will surely die. But when I read my Bible, I find out that Adam and Eve kept walking around the garden. They kept talking. They went and made clothes and hid behind a bush. Dead people here in North Dakota don't do that. When they die here in North Dakota, they turn blue, get stiff, we put them in a box and bury them in the ground. So I want to know, did God lie? If God didn't lie, then what happened? Somebody tell me what happened. Naomi.
They had a spiritual death.
It was a spiritual death. See, what happened was Adam's spirit died. Adam's body didn't die. His soul didn't die. And let me help some of you here with your doctrine. God said, let us make man in our image. God is a spirit. He was a body when Jesus came to earth, put on a human body. And God is a soul. You have the Father God, who is the creator and the designer of the universe. You have Jesus the Son, who was there in the beginning and did everything that his Father said. Jesus was the one who made the world. God the Father thought it up. Jesus the Son did it. He says, in the beginning was the Word, and there was nothing made that was made without him. He was the one who made it. But the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, breathed on creation and it came to life. And hovered over creation. So you had Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bible says we're made in the image of God. We are spirit We are soul and we are body. Some Christians mix up. They get confused. They're confused in their own doctrine. They get mixed up between the soul and the spirit. And we know that they're three things because we're made in the image of God. You can, in fact, the scripture says the word of God is powerful and sharp and can divide asunder between soul and spirit. So if the soul and spirit can be divided, we know they're two different things. So we are made in the image of God, spirit, soul, and body. So when God breathed into Adam the breath of life, he became a living soul. When he sinned, his spirit died. Now there's only one way. From that point on, every baby that's ever been born was born with a dead little spirit on the inside. And there's only one way for that spirit to come to life again. Who thinks they know what it is? Owen.
Baptism?
Not baptism. Yes.
Born again.
Getting born again, asking Jesus to come into your heart, because then his spirit comes inside your spirit and you become a living soul. And from that point on, it's up to you how strong and big you want your spirit. Remember what I said last night? If you read your Bible every day, your spirit will get a little stronger. If you worship God on a regular basis, your spirit will get a little stronger. When you get filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit and you pray in tongues on a regular basis, your spirit will get a little stronger. When you read the word, your spirit gets stronger. When you go and hear the word taught like I'm doing today, your spirit gets stronger. But when you don't read the word every day, if you don't worship God on a regular basis, when you don't go to church and hear the word of God preached, see, you control how strong you want your spirit man to be. That is out of the control of God. That is entirely up to you. That's why you come to conferences like this. You can have as flimsy and puny a little spirit as you want. Now, God will never leave your spirit. You will still go to heaven when you die. But you'll go there a sloppy, floppy Christian. Not one who's walking in the victory and the glory of God.
Thank you for watching this video today. I'd love to know your thoughts and whether or not it has helped you understand a little bit more about the things of the Spirit. Please leave a comment below. Don't forget to subscribe and check out my other videos. And I'll see you next time.